nominate and post to new the commissioner here for the NBA Canada as it ever enters its fifth season. We're going to be talking about his tour across all the league's franchise cities and his reaction to those cities and the reaction of them as he embarks on some of them.
And this new commissioner surely can relate to the players, as David Magley was a former player himself, drafted 28th overall in 1982 by the Cleveland Cavaliers. And a little fun fact for those at home, was actually one of the players traded for Bill Laimbeer, former or future Detroit Pistons bat.
That's right.
Now, Brett, business-wise, he's known as the turnaround specialist. How do you feel he's going to turn the NBL around, especially after last season?
Well, as a new commissioner, he's going to look at this with small business. In order to make a small business, he's a big business, you got to start small. You got to be able to look at the viability of your franchises and increase on the viability of those franchises. We want to increase our stay in Ontario and East Canada, as well as the improvements in Western Canada. So a lot of big shoes to fill, but
well, we're just about ready to get to Dylan Collis at the podium.
All right, thanks, guys. First of all, just want to welcome everyone here. Thank you guys all for coming out. Some familiar faces. It's good to see you again in the offseason here before we get started on another year and another road to a championship, hopefully, for us for a three-peat for the Windsor Express. We're here tonight to meet Commissioner Magley, newly appointed in May. He's on a tour of all the Canadian team markets in our league. This will be the second stop of the tour. Started out east of St. John. Popular spots come down here in Windsor to be at the current champions. So I'm not going to waste too much time speaking myself. This night's about the commissioner and about the fans, to ask him any kind of questions that you guys might have for him. And we're looking really forward to hearing from our great community that we have here in Windsor. So that being said, I'd like to introduce the new NBL Canada commissioner, David Magley.
Thanks for having me. It's been a whirlwind, 45 days so far since I was announced as commissioner. I've been through every market, but I haven't had town hall meetings in every market. We will, but it's important that, you know, we go places where we can answer questions, and there were some markets that weren't prepared to have questions answered for yet. There are changes that were coming in those markets, and until we could secure the right answers, I didn't want to go in there. So we'll be in every market in the NBL Canada in the next probably 60 days. It's been a crazy time, and it was made crazier by coming to Windsor this week. Spending 2 days with Dartus Willis is unbelievable. I have more garlic in me than I think I've eaten in a long time, because the guy loves Italian food, and we've been to some of the best restaurants I've been to in a very, very long time. But just as I thought I was going to gain weight, I had to start running with them between buildings and going from place to place. And the little guy hustles, man. He is a working machine. And I've really enjoyed my time getting to watch him firsthand, because as a coach, you don't see this part of him. Today, we walked through the city of Windsor downtown with he and Coach Jones. And it was amazing to watch the number of cars that stopped and blew their horn and said, "Hey, Coach Jones, hey, Dartus, hey." They didn't get the same way. But it's a remarkable thing. It's like our office is in London right now, and Vito Poggio, the owner of the Lightning, when I go out with him, people recognize him, and they recognize him because he's been there a long time in the community. He's been there because he's put a wonderful product together in the London Lightning. But he's been there for well over 50 years living there. Dartus has been here 3 years, and he's recognized him incredibly. So hats off to the job that the Windsor Express are doing. And again, from a business standpoint, I didn't get a chance to see that when I was a general manager and coach. Thank you all for just getting here as well. Next comment I want to make is that I've got some priorities that we're working with the league. Again, we will take every question that you have tonight, but I'll give you just a little bit of direction on what we're doing. I came in with a kind of a three-part strategy. I wanted to secure our reputation. I wanted to improve the reputation. I wanted it to be a league that people are proud of, that that we, everything we do correctly. Game 7 was something that we're all very much aware of, and it is an event that happened. But Game 7 was not the end of our league. If anything, it was probably the beginning. It was the first time in the history of our league where our 8 owners stopped looking at themselves as 8 franchise owners that cared about the individual teams, but they're 8 owners of a league. They're 8 owners of one thing that they have to come together. They've got to vote together. They've got to do things that's best for the league. They couldn't cut the league apart as they do in the Old Testament, and they say which one has the child, we'll cut it in half and figure it out. All 8 of them had to come together and vote together and do what was right. Watching them operate as an ownership group the last 45 days has been remarkable because they really are on the same page. And it's the first time in 4 years we've been that way. So it's an exciting time, and we're getting some really good things happen. I've got to be at the Niagara River Lions press conference my first day when they announced that they were what the name of their team was, what their color was. And a river lion, while a fictional animal, is a very real thing. It's on their coat of arms, and it's the protector of their region. So it's a pretty cool mascot, and their colors are really neat. They're the same colors as the Seattle Seahawks, and it's going to be really, really well received. Then I went out east, and I spent time with a lot of the teams out there and saw where they were and saw what we needed to shore up, talked to a potential expansion organization, looked at Moncton, looked at Halifax, was around PEI, did our first town hall meeting in St. John. After that, I spent a lot of time on the road trying to focus on finding more players. So as we try to shore up our image, first thing is we want to do is shore up our ownership group, make certain that everybody there is supporting their community, is supporting their players, supporting their fans. We have the right people with the right funding to do it the right way. But as we look at the other images, we got to become more of an international league. People should know who we are. There are people in Windsor that don't know about the Windsor Express, but there's a whole lot of people around the world that don't know us. So we're going to go out, and we're on a 16 to 20 city tour around North America, holding combines, tryout events, looking for talent, finding talent. So instead of having everybody have to come to Toronto and try out for us, we're going. I've been to Southfield, Indiana. I've been to Las Vegas. I've been to Orlando, Florida. I've been to Los Angeles, California. I've got trips next weekend. I'm going to go to Buffalo, New York. And again, we're going to go to Washington, D.C. We're going to be in Calgary. We're going to be in Edmonton. We're going to be in Vancouver. We're going to be in Montreal. We're looking all over North America for the best talent we can for our league. Gives us great exposure, gives us great talent. Quite frankly, we're generating revenue. So the league is going to start generating revenue to help these franchisees not have to spend all of their money just to prop the league up. So that's kind of first thing we do. Second thing is, again, try to generate revenue for the league so that the league is self-sustaining. The ultimate goal is that these guys can generate, I can generate enough money that maybe one day they not only are putting money in to keep the league afloat, but they're actually able to cut dividend checks for what the league generates as well. And the last piece is get into the local market and see if we can help each market succeed financially. That's where we come to Windsor. When we're here in the last 2 days, we spent a lot of time meeting with the movers and the shakers of Windsor and talking about what they can do to help the Windsor Express. A 2-time NBL Canada champion Windsor Express, a team that should be averaging 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 people a game. They've got a wonderfully supportive group that are sitting in front of me right now, and I'm very impressed by the way you all cheer for your fans, cheer for your team. I love when I come out as an opposing coach and you graciously say, "Coach Mags, I love how you talk to your guys. I love your spirit. I think you're awesome. And then if we start winning, sit down, Coach Mags. You're blocking my view." And your wonderful hometown fans that love your Express, and I think that's awesome. But there's not enough. We need to get this thing up to 2,000 people a game. We need to do the things that help the Windsor Express stay here for a long, long time. The value that this franchise brings to this market is far beyond what they do out on that court. When a hockey player walks into an arena, into a school to speak, they pretty much look like the other students, except for they've got bigger thighs. Probably wearing pants, you don't see those. Our guys walk in, DeAndre Thomas blocks out the sun. Everybody knows he's when he walks in. And when they walk in to talk to students about anti-bullying, about staying in school, about drugs, about the importance of education, or whatever message we need to deliver to our young people, we have a platform because we're pro athletes. That's important to your community. the diversity of this franchise is important to your community. The revenue that we can generate for this market with games and fans and additional jobs are important to this community. So we are going to come out to you and we are going to ask for your help. We are going to ask you to help us get more bums in the seats and listen to your ideas of how we can do that. So just wanted to kind of give you our vision real quick before we get started and then kind of open it up for questions. And if Dylan or whoever else is following them online and they want to throw some my hat. I love your fans because you've got people who say, Coach Mags, I can't get there. Can you answer these questions for me? Which is just great. I think that's awesome that they care that much. So let's start and we'll just kind of open up from there. Doris, you can help me find people or Dylan, you can help me find folks with questions because the lights are
open. Yeah, I'll help you find some questions too. And like I said, if anyone is watching at home on Coachio, they can tweet in their questions with the commissioner and I'll pass them along and have an answer for you. So we're going to open it up to media and fans, not in any order.
Well, I think you'd be shocked. We've had that question a few times this last couple of days. And I've been informed how much people love Coach Jones. And just for the record, I don't love him as much. He's made me look bad too many times. He's great. To be quite frank, the announcements came out. They were swift. They were harsh. They were strong. They were steep. We have moved past that in a lot of ways. We've moved past that in that we've gotten more investment in the league. We've got new owners that are coming in different markets. And our primary focus right now is getting that heavy lifting done. As we get closer to the season, I think we will absolutely leave time for appeals and conversations and suspensions being looked at that point. We just need to get through the next couple months of heavy lifting, I say. It's important that Halifax plays this year. It's important that the right owners own that franchise. It's important that local owners own the Moncton franchise. It's important that if another franchise is really close to coming in, comes in, that we're ready for them. So while I think it's fair to all the participants to have their day in court and listen and be heard, I'd rather that conversation take later than sooner, only because we want to get the stuff that's really paramount to the league right now taken care of, if that's fair.
All the penalties and everything else that went on with that, was that made by the board so quickly that I thought it was a little bit harsh on the players themselves because they have to do what they're told. And players don't make that kind of money to be punished as severe and be suspended on top of them, the severe payment that they have to make. We lose a great amount of players. I thought it was a little harsh to make such a decision so quickly. Was that made by a board of people, or was that made by an individual?
It was made by our board of health.
Dave, too, I'll, you want to repeat the question, too?
So the question is, the swiftness and the strength of the fines and punishments of the players after game seven seemed to be almost overboard as far as this gentleman's opinion. With regards to the players really not making the kind of money to be able to handle their fines, that it seemed to be really harsh. Who made the decision, basically? Was it made by a board? Was it made by an individual? It was made by our board of governors. Our owners made that ruling. And again, was swift, was quick, was harsh. But it's a pretty devastating thing that happened. I mean, we do have to, not to, for those of you that were here that night, you came wanting to play. Artis has made the comment that he would have rather lose the game and play it than win the way they did. Not because we're not proud of being champions in Windsor, but that's just not a great look for this league or any league. I would love to hear someone tell me the last time they've heard of any league ever do that before, because I've never heard of it before. So it's something that's significant that can never happen again, and that's what the statement was. Is it fair? I can't judge that. Will they be reviewed? I'm certain that as we get closer to the season, we'll leave an option open to be able to review whatever we need to review. And again, I won't make that decision because I'm not the one that originally ruled, but I'm certain I'll be involved in the conversation as it gets closer to that point.
I know some have called it kind of becoming the Raptors D-League team, but what's your take on the loss of Mississauga to the NBL?
Well, I think that that's a wonderful question. If you didn't hear, they asked about the loss of the power to the Raptors, the power becoming the power that market becoming the Raptors 905. I think the fact of the matter is the greater Toronto area is a very difficult place for the NBL to exist. If you didn't have the Raptors, we would be, no one would ever use the term minor league with the NBL Canada. We would be Canada's pro league. There's no minor league in Mexico. There's no minor league in Europe. There's no minor league in Asia. But because we happen to have a professional basketball team in the greater Toronto area, they'll put the moniker minor league around our league, which probably isn't fair, and hopefully we'll break that in time. But if the Raptors want to have a team close by, Mississauga's 40 minutes from where they play their main games. The NBA's model is you want that D-League team as close as you can so a young man can practice with the NBA team, go down practice, play in a game with the D-League, and then come back the next day and play for the Raptors in practice again. There's a lot of control they can have on that. There's no great secret that the Power have not had a great program, a great product in the last few years. It's been difficult to compete because it's a tough market to be in. So a guy like Henry Child that owns the Power, that gave us his money, that gave us his support, that stepped in when the Oshawa Power were struggling, kept them afloat, moved them to Mississauga, gets offered a chance to join the NBA, to be a part of the Raptors, to take his franchise and absolve it and let the Raptors kind of take him, but he still is a part of it. His managers get to be a part of it. That's a win for that individual, which should be a win for us. If one of our players had a chance, if Quinnell Brown could go play for the Raptors, we sure wouldn't say, sorry, bud, we need to win another championship. We'd say, go knock yourself out, man. This is pretty darn cool. So from that standpoint, we're looking at that. The other thing is the NBA was very sensitive to our league. I don't know if it came from Adam Silver, but I would guess it probably did. They didn't want us to be burned. They were very careful. The Raptors called me specifically and said, Mr. Commissioner, can you come downtown and meet with us and talk to us about this thing we want to do? So well before it occurred, they brought me in, they spoke with me, and they said, what can we do to make certain that the people of the NBL Canada know we respect their league, that this is a decision that you have some say in, and if you absolutely say no, then we'll have to have that conversation. And I thought, that was awfully nice, because we've really struggled to have a relationship with the Raptors. We've struggled to have anything with the NBA. For the Raptors to put their stamp of approval for Masai or Dwayne Casey to say congratulations on our 50th anniversary that's coming up, for them possibly to play us in an exhibition game with their new D-League team. All of those things legitimize our league. Let's face it, they're Canada's team. There's no other team in North America that has 10,000 people outside their gym jumping up and down like the Toronto Raptors do when they're playing in another arena in the playoffs. We can build on that. We can leverage that relationship. It can be positive for our league. So at the end of the day, disappointed the Power's gone. I think it went about as good as it possibly could, and I think we all kind of win on that. And we got to be, the Raptors got what they wanted, and I think we've got a better reputation or better relationship with them than we've ever had.
Got a question from at home, actually. Scott Chisholm tweeted in, and we knew this one was going to come. What about the uncertainty in Halifax and Moncton? How does the league move forward with these franchises not operating?
Well, Scott, if you can't be down here live, I will not be answering your question. No, I'm kidding. Halifax and Moncton are very, very important to us. Halifax is gone today, but it's coming back, and it's coming back quickly. I'm in negotiations with several of the key business stakeholders in Halifax. They absolutely want to be involved with the team. The team's going to be coming back. It's going to be coming back. I would say in August we're going to have some wonderful announcements. It's going to be locally owned. It's going to be owned by people that love their Halifax Rainmen. Will they be called the Rainmen? I don't know. That'll be their prerogative, what they want to do. But I'm fully confident that the Halifax franchise will play this season. Moncton is in a similar situation, although they have not gone bankrupt. They are pretty much owned by several of the owners in our league this year. And those guys are more than happy to let that ownership slip so that everybody has one team. And we're looking for the right local businessman in Moncton that I think we've identified, and we're not quite there yet, but if he says yay in the next week or two, we could have good announcements as well there, where Moncton will have the proper local ownership, the proper support they haven't had. Think about this, Moncton has never had a winning record, and they have 600 season ticket holders. They average 1,200 fans. I believe that's the second most in the league, or pretty darn close to it. That's pretty good. You know, I'm not going to be 1,200 paid people for a team that's never had a winning record. Imagine what happens if local ownership steps in, they invest in the proper staff, the proper players, and they put a winning product out there. Moncton could be a great market for us. So it's really important geographically. For those of you that don't know the Maritimes like I do, I just learned it a few weeks ago, it's pretty important to the rest of those other markets because it's really close to Halifax. It's really close, really, relatively speaking, close to PEI, close enough to St. John. And should another market come up, say, Cape Breton, not too far away either. So we really need to have Moncton solid this year, and that's our primary goal for Moncton, is to get the proper folks in there.
Speaking of local ownership, I know you talked with the CBC and said you kind of want to see more local ownership within Windsor Express. I talked with Darvis about this on Tuesday. What do you mean by that?
Well, we've talked a lot about that the last couple of days, and we don't know exactly how that looks. We don't know if one guy comes in and joins with them, or 10 guys come in and join with them, or just they create an advisory board that becomes part of the face of the organization. No one in this league, from what I can tell, has outworked Dartis Willis. He crosses that bridge every morning early. He's first one in his office, and he's last one to leave. He's worked really, really hard to help create the Windsor Express. But at the end of the day, Dartis doesn't have lifetime relationships that are in Windsor. Dartis doesn't have the ability to walk into someone that has said no and said, wait a minute, remember when we were kids and we did this, or remember when we went someplace or take them to their favorite restaurant, but we have people in Windsor that have those relationships. We have significant people that live here that love the Express and love Dartis that we need to get involved if we're going to really get the entire community going. Once they warm the market, we can let this little Tasmanian devil go, and he's going to rock it because he's going to create programs that's best for everybody involved. But without that relationship, it's hard to really crack that significant number of 2,000, 3,000, and 4,000 people that it takes to create a sustainable long-term franchise here in Windsor. So I think it's important that we get, however that looks, an additional partner, multiple partners, or somebody that doesn't have ownership, but they're invested because of their commitments as an organization, as an advisory group. We've got to get that going here in Windsor. So thank you for the question.
If we eliminate London from the fan base, what is the average attendance of the game?
It's London sends it. London's over 5,000. London is the just small, but the second largest fan base in North America of fans of basketball, professional basketball fans that aren't in the NBA for professional basketball. So they are definitely somebody that changes the arm for us. We're probably looking closer in the low 1,200 to 1,400 fans a game. And again, our numbers too. If we can get to 2,000 fans, These teams will all break even. Well, if they can break even on their fan base and their support and their sponsorships and all the other revenue generators that they use, we'll send them over the top and they'll make money. Because several teams that are pretty darn close to that. But we need to get everybody over that. So that's our goal. So if you look at that here, we probably need to consistently bring another 750 to 1,000 people into this place every day. Is that fair? Yeah.
Just 1,500.
Yeah, 1,500 gets some real healthy quick.
Yeah, I agree. The front here, Dan.
Commissioner, you talked about Niagara coming into the league, and you talked about Moncton and Halifax. You alluded to the possibility of some emerging markets. Are you in a position yet to talk about that?
Well, Cape Breton has been talked about. There's been articles written about Cape Breton. Cape Breton is unique because Andre Livingston, that was the owner and one of the founders of the league, his son, who used to work for the Halifax Rainmen, left mid-season last year and started looking for an opportunity to do a franchise. He looked at Fredericton first, couldn't find the right venue, found a couple of people with some significant funding in Cape Breton, and went to Cape Breton. Unbeknownst to him, an amazing arena. Who knew that Cape Breton was a big basketball market? Cape Breton University and St. FX have an incredible rivalry, and when they play in the playoffs, they'll put 7,000-8,000 people, 6,000-7,000 people in their arena there in Sydney. So a lot of things lined up for him. We've not gotten that deal done yet. Is it going to happen? I feel pretty good about it, but I couldn't say it's over 50-50. We need a franchise in Kitchener-Waterloo. I don't think there's any secret to that. I had a phone call from a young man today about it. There's other people that we're talking to. There's markets that logically make sense that I don't have any candidates for today, like Montreal, like Quebec City, maybe Kingston. Really closing in our market, Ottawa, so that we have all of our major markets from Windsor to the East Coast covered. Once we're pretty comfortable with that, and the franchises are all getting profitable, the league is sustainable, then we need to go out west. And then when we go out west, we want one or two divisions out there. So we can't go one team at a time in the west. We got to go four teams at a time so that they have people to play against. So that's some significant heavy lifting. But you have some very successful CFL franchises out that way. And maybe those owners might be interested in a model as we prove it out to be very successful. So we're hoping the next year or two will justify our chance to go out there and really look serious at that market.
Yeah, in the back.
Earlier you had stated that you are and have been traveling all across North America, presumably looking at the camps, combines, individual talent. What are the major reasons and benefits that you or anybody in the NBL have been presenting to these players who want to join this league?
Well, first of all, our pay wage has gotten better as the European income has gone down, quite frankly. I mean, there was a time a couple years ago where we were just an average pay league. Now we're one of the better leagues you're going to find. You're going to play in a market that's going to have a very fast-paced play of basketball, very high-level basketball. It's akin to the D-League, and it's similar to the NBA because of the pace that we play at and the style of play that the coaches. Coaches are going to coach you up really good, and our guys are getting opportunities to go on and play at other levels. Several of our players are playing in the NBA Summer League this summer, and you know other guys have gone on to play in Spain and Germany, and Greece. We have opportunities to play all over the world, so it's a wonderful league. The experience of playing in a big arena consistently has been a pretty cool thing. So you know when folks are coming in, when I cross the border and I go into America, there's thousands of people lined up to get in here and play basketball. We needed to get them their passports because we don't have enough passports there. But there's a lot of folks that want to get in this league and play. There's a lot of disappointing people when they don't get phone calls the next couple weeks after combine because they really want to play in our league. It's just someplace that, and you know what? I haven't heard one person say what happened in Game 7. They just don't care. They want to be pro basketball players. I think, you know, we've historically, through the Windsor Express and Dardis and Bill being from Detroit, have had pretty good conversations with the Pistons. You know, when you had your first game at the Coliseum, Rick Mahorn was there and Charles Jones was there. And, you know, multiple players, former really good players with the Pistons, came in to support you all. I think through these guys, this would be our conduit to get to know the Pistons better. And I think at time we absolutely can work on that. It's a great suggestion.
Just one question from home again to Greg. I don't know how we can answer this, but just give your comments. He says, can we look at moving the team downtown to help create walking traffic to increase attendance?
We absolutely can. All we need is a place to play.
Yeah.
I mean, there's one venue downtown that you're all familiar with that's not ready to play basketball in right now. And, you know, If there was a place to play, that's a conversation we got to look to. But right now, there's just not a venue that makes sense. Yes.
In relation to that is our home here seems to be restricted and quite a few fronts. How can we overcome that? Because I think we're kind of not landlocked, but I guess business locked into a business where we cannot advertise as much as we would like and sell products. And
I've got to tell you, very impressed by your mayor. Mayor spends his own dime to take his kids go to Halifax on championship series and support the team. Not many mayors across this country are supporting a local team like that. The mayor and the city council pretty much control this building, if I'm not wrong. And I think we're in a moment to have the discussions with how can we best serve the survivability. I mean, there really is three phases. You got to get survivability, sustainability, and the profitability. If we can just survive the next couple of years and get to the point of break even, and we can sustain that, then we can show some profitability. Man, you can charge us whatever you want to in this arena, and we'll be more than happy to support it. But we need some help to get there. And that's going to be a conversation that it needs to happen with the city about how can we best make this venue not only home for a long time, but a home that we can survive in and get to sustainability pretty quickly. So, you know, I appreciate the question. It's something that's on top of mind. So, bear with me.
Definitely on top.
Okay. Yes?
Is there any way, I've thought about doing this myself, it irks me to no end that this league, I didn't think I was a basketball guy, but a lot of people, when they started coming to games, they really enjoyed it. That's coming from a hockey family, right? It amazes me when I looked on Sportsnet, or the great TSN's webpage, and here this is our only basketball league in Canada, professional basketball league in Canada, right? And there's nothing on there. And I almost felt like myself making a, it might seem laughable, like you can make a complaint with the CRTC, because you would know, growing up in Indiana, right? Here in Windsor, Canada, you're subjected to your whole life all kinds of bizarre Canadian content laws, right? Music, everything else. And it just blows my mind that our national media doesn't give the league a chance by even publishing the standings or the scores. That just blows my mind in a country that's supposed to be promoting itself. And then all kinds of other crazy stuff.
Please don't take this the wrong way, but I think I love you. A hockey guy that is complaining about lack of support that's willing to do something about that, man, you're a gem, bro. You're absolutely right. We've got to become significant enough in the league that at least they'll run our scores at the bottom. At least they'll treat us, whether it's TSN, ESPN, the local, or even the Toronto papers, if they'll give us enough love to at least acknowledge, we're not asking for full game coverage, we're not asking for video, we're not asking, just give us a line at the bottom.
I think that score would help.
It would be huge.
Because people then say, oh, it's this league.
They would talk about what's the NBL Canada. So first thing is, feel free to complain.
All right.
Feel free to call the CRTC or whoever they are you talked about. Secondly is that I've got to build relationships with those people. Maybe the Raptors can help introduce me to someone that's in the local press there, that's with the TSN, that would say, you know what, let's talk about it. We're gonna partner with some local news type basketball people like North Pole Hoops and On Point Basketball out of Toronto that do a lot of online media generation. I think will help create more awareness, and they seem to get the attention of TSN and some other people occasionally. So there's multiple ways we're trying to go at them, but it's not as easy as just going at them. It's like, one of the questions is, why can't we get all of our games on TV or some of our games on TV? You guys have one of the best deals going because you'll have a TV, you have a game online, you'll tape it and then you'll tape delay it so you can see it, which is a pretty cool thing. Today, because we don't have quite a significant enough of a fan base and we're not broad nationally, it's hard to get TSN or someone to say we're going to pony up the money. So what they'll do is they'll say, well, you're more than welcome to have a TV game. All you got to do is pay us $20,000 for our trucks to come and produce it, and you can sell the commercials. We're struggling to get enough money to keep our franchises alive. To go out and ask for a bunch of money for commercials just seems to be carpet for the horse. So will we one day be on TV? Absolutely. Is that this year? Probably not. Now, what you could see, And you could see us try to monetize our 300,000 plus people that watch us on YouTube. You could see us come in and say, well, hey, if you're liking the games on YouTube, and Alejandro talking about me, or Brett, who does an amazing job talking about the game, we might come back and say, how about $29 for your season pass to support the Windsor Express, or to support your local team, or how about $49 for a league pass. Something that we can actually get a little bit of money off that YouTube feed that we do, which would then generate additional revenue for the league, which then helps the teams and everybody else. So, you know, we're looking at means that we could get that done right now.
Yeah, Mike?
I'm just going to piggyback on the Canadian content comment. CIS, the university circuit here in Canada, is growing exponentially. What can you do to attract these players from going over to Europe or Australia? For example, Dean Phillip, who led the Lancers in scoring and rebounding, went over to play in Australia. How can you attract players like that to come play in this league?
Hey, you know, one of the difficulties, they say, why don't you take our league from four Canadians to six? Would love to. We need to increase our salary cap. The fact of the matter is, for the type of players that we have, the salaries that we can play, there's 10 times the number of Americans that can play with that than the Canadians can. So if we start to go to a fifth and a sixth Canadian without increasing our salary cap, there's Canadians that can build. We can go to 9 Canadians tomorrow. But if we do, we're going to have to get a much bigger salary cap, because we've got to get Liam Phillips back from Australia. We've got to get Mike Frazier back from Lebanon. We've got to get Javon Taylor back from Italy. And there's just player after player after player that's a wonderful Canadian player that would thrive in our league that are making $8,000 and $10,000 and $12,000 a month. We can't increase our salary cap until we can get the profitability. So it makes it complicated, because good Lord knows we want to get them back here. When they come back, they do really well. Last year we had a young man named Kyle Johnson that played really good for us and helped us beat the London Lightning before we came here. He had 28 points the last game. Unfortunately for me, Kyle Johnson has a Great Britain passport, and he was able to get a job in Italy the next day, making 2 to 3 times what I could pay him here in the NBL Canada. Just as I said with the power, or a guy trying to go to the NBA, who are we to stand between a guy and have a chance to make that kind of living? We had to let him go do what he had to do. So there's a day coming when our Canadian content's gonna go up, where we're gonna get our better CIS players to stay, but all that's tied to profitability. Because we have more money, we have more, no problem spending it the way we need to grow the business.
You were the coach of the Brandon Bates for the past 2 years, but prior to that, you didn't have a lot more experience in the USA. So I'm just kind of curious, why do you feel you are the best fit to be commissioner of the National Basketball League?
I was the only one that applied for the job. So I went. Honestly, I have a strong business background. And my business background is about taking small companies. A small company in Kansas that was $650,000 in sales. And I told the guy, if you hire me within 5 years, it could be a $10 million business. Today they do $80 million. He was hiring me, getting to $10 million, and firing me so they could grow to the next $80 million. They're still my best friends. They're great people, and I've been able to get and work and understand the nuances of what makes a company profitable, what makes a business grow, what makes it work, and work with the stakeholders, listening to guys like Dardis and Vito and Ian and all of the owners, Duncan and everybody that has a great knowledge of their market and what they want to do, and then implement their plans. I think I'm pretty good at implementing plans. Now, let's back into the fact that I've been at the Brampton A's for 2 years. I've seen everything that's good and bad about our league up front, close and personal, and I think I've got a good feel for how to make this work. So, you know, from that standpoint, I'm uniquely qualified. Now, I dare you to go out and find another guy that was a GM head coach that has that business background to come be the commissioner of the league. If that's what we're looking for, then I'm a pretty good fit.
And for the record, so you don't put that in the paper, or else it was a vetting process for you, and he rose to the top. So that's very important from the NBL standpoint, is that yes, we need someone with the correct experience, someone that understood our league, someone that understood players and coaches, and someone with an NBA background and played overseas. So that's really, really important. So he brought value, no question. And, you know, we support that.
This is like a top to the value.
Yeah.
I like that. You know, I like the mic here. So it brought value, and we're confident. It was a unanimous decision from the board, and I sit on the board. And so we know that the value and hard work. You thought I work hard? This guy's driving all over the country right now. We're excited about that. He's going to work as hard as I am. And so that by itself is a confidence builder in myself.
Thank you.
Another question from a viewer at home. Cliff asks, currently finding any info on stats is virtually impossible. Are there any plans to change the website?
Yes. We are, the year before we used an organization called DAC Stats, and we were able to get things updated quicker. We're probably going back to them. Now we're going to update it much, much quicker. We're looking at ways to create highlight tapes quicker, ways to create videos that we can get online. Again, it's important that our content is seen. The more that people see, feel, touch, and experience the NBL Canada, the greater the likelihood is they're gonna buy into it. You guys have better things to do on a Thursday evening than be entertained by my quick wit and great looks. Joke. But you're out here because you love your Windsor Express and you want to see what's going on next. I mean, this is an impressive showing, I gotta tell you. I'm really appreciative of this group coming out here. But you've experienced it, you've felt it. You love your players, you see your players, you know who they are. Blemishes and all, mistakes they make, that's okay. You love your Windsor Express players. We just need to get a lot more folk doing that across this league, and we're gonna be really good.
What are the pros and cons? There's the ownership
thought
about in moving the season back to
us. Well, I think we saw way more pros than cons. And the initial thing was, none of us did tremendous. A couple times, Windsor possibly, because you've had things to celebrate. You tend to have pretty good people coming out when you're celebrating your championship the next year. So that's fair. Besides that, no one else had great games in December and November and December for whatever reason. Is it Canadian basketball? Is it the market? Is it the winter? Is it we're still getting excited for Christmas? We don't know. But we do know one thing. This season thins out as the OHL season ends and things happen. And if we can play a couple of months longer than they're playing, we get better venue dates, we get a chance to build on it, we get a chance to... Now, the irony of Game 7 allows us a little bit more time to get everything fixed and going even better. So this year it actually is a real blessing because it gives us a chance to do that. One of the questions is, well, can your guys hang on that long and still be here? Hope so. But if they don't, the D-League cuts are all in October, November. So there's a whole lot of really quality players that are going to be wanting to get in this league come our training camp December 1st.
Justin, yeah?
I want to apologize for going back towards the YouTube video parts. There's a lot of videos that have been posted on YouTube by both players and fans showing things like the scuffles and so forth, you know, players being stepped on by other players during the match and so forth. What do you plan to do or prevent things like that from happening in the future?
Hopefully not give them so much access to being able to edit video. we have to make our game. Look, when the malice at the palace happened and Ron Artest ran up in the stands in Detroit and beat some fans up, the NBA reacted. The way they reacted, they came up with NBA Cares. They did more in the community. The players started dressing like Dardis, because I don't have the money to dress like that, but NBA guys do. And they started looking sharper, and they started calling the games a little bit tighter. They took away some of the hand checking. They took away some of the hard fouls. They took away, and the game changed. It became a little faster game, and it became a better game. We need to do that. We need to correct a few rules, make the game speed up a little bit, take a little bit of the banging out of it to create a little bit less of the types of things that you see. And then in the NBA, they've got something called a flagrant one and a flagrant two foul. Flagrant one is I foul you hard, I knock you down, but I didn't hurt you and I sure didn't intend to hurt you. It's a technical, you shoot the free throws, you get the ball back. Flagrant two means I went for your head. I went above your shoulder. You were going too hard. There was a player from Halifax that put his knee straight at Tony Bennett's shoulder. That's a flagrant two. That you're out of that game, and then the commissioner's going to look and see if you're going to play any more games that series. Be quite frankly, if we had made some of those decisions earlier in the series, Game 7 probably doesn't ever happen the way it did. So we've got rules that are going to come in. They're going to be tweaked, and we're going to really watch how we call what we call them. You know, some things will probably be tighter than we're used to and a little bit uncomfortable the first month or two of the season, but guys will adjust, Russ will adjust, and it'll be a great game as the season goes on. We'll never have that experience happen again.
Yeah, Laura?
with respect to the referee, has any consideration been given to improving that? And I'm not saying that as a sore loser of any kind. It just seemed a lot of times, a lot of the animosity between teams came from poor calls, calls that weren't made that should have been made, and I think that's a serious consideration that should be made.
I think it's a very fair point. You've got a unique coach because he doesn't give any time. You've got a unique coach because he doesn't ever blame the refs for games. The head of officials said Bill Jones has never called him one time to complain about a ref and make it the reason why they've lost the game. Hats off to him. I'm not that good. I've absolutely told him there's things I thought they didn't do well before. But the first thing we have to do is we have to acknowledge what we're working with. These guys work a high school game on Tuesday. On Thursday, they work a college or a CIS game. And then on Friday, they come out and rep our game. Those are totally different games. The speed, size, the strength, the skill is much, much different. So we need to give them easier rules to interpret to help them. We need to give them better respect. I didn't get a technical this year. And proud of that. Good Christian boy. I never got technical. I was out of my box 30% of the time. I deserve a technical. I didn't get a technical because relative to other guys, I'm a pretty darn good guy. Well, it shouldn't be relative to other guys. The rule is the rule is the rule. You got the box or the technical. We have guys in our league that you say Dardis is the captain and I'm on Dardis' team. Dardis should be the only guy consistently talking to a rep. Yeah, we have guys on our team, we have guys on your team, guys on my team. They make a mistake, or they get a foul, they don't get a call, oh, they're talking to the ref, and they're beating the ref up. And these guys, they're human, but they're also, you know, they repped high school and CIS, now they got grown men in their face yelling at them. So we've got to correct a little bit of that, which doesn't let them off the hook of being better than what they are. So the last thing is we've got to figure out a way, whether it's an NBA clinic, whether it's a review process that we're watching closer, whether we're taking people like Coach Jones and saying, this year we want you to help us review the refs on a regular basis. We'd like you to work with Mike Balloon and see what we can do to make this thing better. I mean, we've got to do something that helps our guys become the very best they can. Because I can tell you this, for the most part, they're not bad men. For the most part, they really care. For the most part, they're trying to be fair. And so, I can honestly say I don't think I've ever been cheated maliciously. I've had things I thought weren't done right, but I think we have to get it better. So I agree with you, we gotta improve it, but we've gotta improve many aspects, not just the education piece and their ability to call. Long-term goal, fiscal responsibility, financially, I'd like to pay our refs enough that they don't need to go rep high school, they don't need to rep CIS or college. All they rep, all they see is our big bodies running up and down the court. They get used to calling that kind of a game, and I think they're going to be a lot better consistently because it's a much easier way to rep.
Just want to check with our guys back there. We have time for any more questions? Or?
I have a fan question that came in from Facebook from a fan group from Young Canada that basically is involving, now it's kind of a little bit off topic, but at the same time involves the suspension for Jonathan Mills, who was suspended for the year for conduct detrimental to the ring, to the league, I should say. They are asking, can you basically explain why he was suspended and so forth? I got back requests from a few fans from London.
I appreciate that. Not to be coy or not to be less than forthright, what came in through the London Lightning to us in the last week or two created a desire that it was time for that young man not to be in our league for the next year. In an effort to protect his privacy and to help him go into the next phase of his life, we thought it wouldn't be prudent for us to talk about that, and so I won't. So that's, you know, that's the one answer I won't be very direct on, because I'm not going to have that conversation, because that's something as a league we decided it's better on than this one in a circumstance to protect them and say that what it was detrimental to our league.
One.
That was exactly how Dardis wrote it for me earlier. I'm glad.
So a couple more questions, guys. That's all we have time for here.
Would you say that that's the, like, that's where this idea of clinics or
looking at the rest, so it comes into play. Those and not the penalties from the final, so on and so forth.
I didn't understand the last part.
I'm sorry. Just like, would you say that, given the penalties that happened after Game 7, the recent suspension of Jonathan Mills, would you say that's where ideas like this NBL clinic could come in hand or could help?
Well, I mean, I think there's an education piece to what we have to do. As we adjust our rules, then I need to go to every team and every training camp and say, guys, listen, we're going to drug test before the first game every player in this league. We're going to let the owners make the decision on what they do with the results. They'll share them with us, and then whatever they do, they do. Then we're going to come back halfway through the season, and we're going to test them again, and the third time we'll test them again. We're going to make certain that our league is what we want it to be. We're also going to make the conversation that these are the points of emphasis of our league this year. You go out, somebody said, you hit somebody in a handshake line. We have teams that can't shake hands because the players can't control their emotions after the game. And I've got one of those teams. I mean, don't get me wrong. I've gone to Bill and said, Bill, I think it's better for our guys not to shake hands this game. We're professional basketball players. We've got to be better than that. And if you as young men can't come in and present yourself in a way that's better controlled, you won't play in the NBL Canada. I don't care who you are. And those are strong conversations we need to have with our guys. It's just simple. It's simple, cordial rules of life. Amen. She agrees 100%.
I was always disappointed to see, it didn't matter how bad that game is, you guys shake hands before you leave this floor. And when that never happened, I was so disappointed.
But it's not been mandatory.
It's not mandatory.
Mr. Commissioner, your passion for this league is clear. Your passion for this league is strong. What legacy are you looking to build here for your future? And how can we fans help you do that?
I love that question. I've got a 2-year contract. My goal is, I feel like I'm on assignment for 2 years. And the goal isn't to get 2 more years. The goal is to accomplish what I need to get in 2 years. I need to get this league good image. I need to get this league great financial profitability, and I need to make our franchises profitable. At the end of 2 years, if you love me, I love you, we got a chance to go and date a little bit longer, we'll keep the court in profit. But ultimately, to your more important question is, how can you help me? You've got to support this guy. You've got to support the guy you're sitting next to. You've got to get your family and friends to come out and experience Windsor Express basketball. And I say Windsor Express basketball, and I say this for every team around the league. If you experience it, it's an amazing product. The other day, I don't know why, I was looking for an old picture of my brother or my father, someone that's no longer with me, to post on Facebook in memory and share some sappy story about how I love my family. And I came across a Game 7 video that was about a minute long of somebody panning, and it might have been Audley, panning our crowd after we beat London. And I'm crying in front of it because I'm so darn happy I finally won a freaking playoff series. But there was over 2,000, there was 1,900 people there. And it felt good. It felt good because it's such a cool place where we're at. And if we can create that type of experience, and if our fans could all see that 1,900 people cheering and celebrating and loving their people the way that our fans did and ramped in that day, it's going to be contagious and it's going to work. But if they're not there, they can't. And it's not the same on TV. It's not this. You've got to get here and experience it. I've had guys tell me, man, I love watching those guys, even when they don't do right, even when they say something they shouldn't. I love watching Coach Jones, you know, look like Crocodile Dundee when the Wild Boar comes and goes, go sit down. Because he's able to control them, and he's done things that most people can't. That's something that we've got to get experience. And if you all can help us do that, if you can help these franchises survive and get to sustainability, I promise you profitability is around the corner. We're going to be really celebrating what we do.
Okay. Just to cut you off there real quick, sorry. That's actually how we're going to finish for Coach Joe's broadcast. We're going to do an outro with Dartus, and once they're wrapped up, we can continue the conversation in the room here. But the viewers at home, I want to thank you for tuning in. We're going to pass it over to those guys to close up the
night. Thank you for the pen.
not the usual.
With Dardis Willis, the president of the Windsor.
It's hard to find people with 3X that wear 3Xs to give all my stuff to. So I'm going, would you like my stuff? Yeah, if I want a tent, but no, I don't, it doesn't matter. What else? Do we have any other questions? Go ahead.
I think the one game was the playoffs when Rick was playing Windsor. I just wonder, like, in the future, like, for safety things, for, like, you guys.
For safety, for, like, the coaches or players. I remember the one game between Brampton and Windsor, things got kind of crazy. I'm sure you remember. There was one character here who was really giving you guys a hard time, and your guys wanted to get at him. You remember that night, right?
Yeah.
Like, is it, I mean, I felt bad for you guys, actually. I mean, I didn't want you to win the game, but it was kind of disturbing to see, like, to me, there's, you know, giving people a hard time, and then there's just, like, yeah. In the future, is it good to have, like, people that close to visiting team?
I think, you know, that was an event that happened. It didn't happen. You know, we played another game after that back in Windsor, and that didn't occur at that time. So Dardis, you know, he put the proper staff in place and made certain that didn't occur. As a coach, I look back on that, I think I probably should have stopped and said, you know, we need to not let this escalate and just have them removed. Which Dardis would have supported that wholeheartedly. But ultimately, what we want to do is make certain that everybody's experience is good, that every fan, every coach, that our players have the proper discord. And, you know, I think we pretty much have that aware. That wasn't, like, not nearly significant as Game 7, but to use Dardis's term, that's an event. And that's an event that we all learn and grow. How do we avoid that? And we arrange where the seats, we watch and we sit where we sit, and we put the right security in place. And then those things can't happen again. So I was at a couple of your games against Halifax, and no incidences whatsoever against them either. So I'm pretty confident that all that stuff is behind us.
Talking about having to possibly go downtown to get the people to come out to the games or what have you, and it seemed like every game at the Coliseum would get pumped up, or the crowd that was there, whatever. Have we ever thought of shuttle buses and bring them to this venue? I think this is an awesome venue. Like, even to bring them from West End here, I'm sure it's been discussed somewhere along the way.
We have experimented with shuttles. Year two and year three. Year two wasn't as successful. We did it from Dirty Jerseys. We did it from the West End this year. We also, Transit Windsor, attempted to get them to support that. We have to grow the fan base as well, which is a double-edged sword, because if you don't have the people already coming, and Transit Windsor can't fill buses, for example. But we have experimented with that. And I think the casino was a test market. It was a test opportunity to see bridging the East and the West, right? What would it look like? Obviously, it was a venue that was a specialty venue that's not used to just holding sports games like that. And it was something special for us. But it also proved that it was accessibility was important. People came out, they came outdoors, they dressed up, they looked different. So again, like Dave said, at the present time, we do not have a venue, but we've looked at other means like you just spoke about. I would hope that as we begin to continue to grow, that people, both in the Tecumseh end, that end, that East end, will come out and just continue to support. It is a challenge though. definitely a challenge.
Have you worked with school boards in regards to have almost like a field day at the game where you have abundance of seats and you would like to put these younger children in here because they'll bring the parents and they'll do this? So that I think the theme of starting up the game when they come the next time, you know, from school A to school B and C and D. Those people will come back.
Yeah.
They thought of approaching the school boards with donating so many seats for a special classroom or a special event or whatever it is that would keep maybe 100, 200 kids on every game that are, I'm going to say, gratis if you have plenty of seats. Does that hinder your, that you have to pay by the seats for the arena? I don't know. I don't understand your policy. How many people you can have?
We do not pay by the seat. There is no limit to how many people we can actually put in. But to ensure that we can pay the bills, we got to keep a certain level when it comes to giving free tickets and promos and all those things. But one of the key things that we do to answer the other part of your question is kids are a focus. And you said it best that if you bring a kid, he's going to bug mom and dad. Or if you go to school, they're going to go and tell mom and dad to come. And since year one, we've always focused on going into the schools. We've taken our whole team in to do events at the school where the coach goes out. We hold a practice. We give out some passes. We've also did promos with businesses where they buy blocks of tickets. Our whole focus is getting the kids to come into the building because they are the future of the fan base, right? So you expose them at the camps today. It's a good example. We had Commissioner out, I was there, the coach, and we did a lot to really make sure that we kind of embedded in them that this is their team, this is their opportunity to have a professional team. So kids are the focus, and yes, we just try to stay creative. We went to over 30 schools this past season. The league does a day game. All the teams in the league did a day game except our team. We did go to the board and ask, could we host a day game, which will allow us to fill it up with public and the private, or public and the Catholic board. And so we get it, you're right. The kids are the way to do it.
How successful was that? Going into school, giving kids to tell the parents. Did you see a turnaround from that?
We did that all season. If you look at things like halftime or the anthem, the kids coming out to sing the anthem, we did that consistently. So I think it was very successful in that if you look at our numbers, kids are the number two group that comes out. Obviously, the 30 to 45 is the number one group, but the kids are the number two group that come out.
Let me address that. We did do a school day game in Brampton. We had 4,500 people at the game. It was crazy. There's a young lady named Sy Dat out of London that features a message about anti-bullying. Kids got there at 10:45. We put on a show for them. She's kind of a hip-hop artist, and they got engaged. They had a lot of fun. Then we came and we had a great game. Ran a little long, so they left about halfway through the third quarter. But it was amazing how they emptied out so quick. But to see the arena full and to see our ability to impact, and now what we did was the county of the region appeal allowed us to have a certain age group that they would bus. And they paid for the buses, they let the kids out of the school, they had the supervisors. We provided the tickets free of charge, but then we went to people that wanted to get messaging to these kids. Canadian Tire Jumpstart and people like that, and they gave us the funding that allowed us to pay for that. And it was quite frankly our most successful game that we've had in 2 years, Mrs. Brampton A's. So the school day game is a wonderful idea, and it works really well. And I'm certain it's something that Dartmouth will revisit this year with our city government.
Do you think you'll try and implement that perhaps across the NBLC, given how successful it was for you in Brampton, given how it sounds like it's been quite a success for Windsor Express, do you think you'd like to see it kind of try different leagues?
Absolutely. I'd like to see it, and I think, quite frankly, it's something we can monetize. It's something that we can go to a large bank that's a national bank and say, how would you like to be our key sponsor for the our school day game across the country? And I think we can generate revenue for the league that way. So, but okay. And anyhow, no, it was. It's something that we love to do, and if we could do it right, we could really send a great message, because it really did impact lives, and we got great feedback. We did it for like three age groups, like sixth, seventh, eighth grades. We opened it up, and we let the schools bid to see who could come in first. I think we could handle 12 schools worth within a day and a half. It was totally sold out. And after we got done, Catholic School Board called, the Peel Region calls, can we do another one? So I think it's something that we could really have a big event from. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Well, Tim Horton, I'm using Tim Horton as one. They have summer camps for the kids and stuff like that. How could you channel in on the industries
some of these industries to sponsor these camps that we would, basketball included?
Well,
McDonald's, Tim Hortons, the industry.
Canadian Tire Jumpstart is pretty remarkable, and they'll support all of our teams. When you go and you watch Bill Jones run a basketball camp, he's got the MVP, Quinnell Brown, there. He's got another one of his staff that's doing repping. Not a very good job repping, but he's doing a job repping. You've got the owner of the Windsor Express challenging some young man with the same clothes he has on today in a push-up contest, of which he won. I was pretty impressed. Barely. It was pretty close. Barely. The kid was strong. But you go, how cool is this that these guys can do this? So we need to get Canadian Tire, and we need to get Tim Hortons, and we need to get these people to help get us in front of as many kids as we can, because the theory is then the kids don't have to pay. Then we take away that one reason why we don't, a lot of kids, they only have so many resources. If we can take that piece away and we can get them in front, then they can have the same experience as anybody else, and we can really leverage our celebrity and our ability to impact lives. And again, I'm watching the messaging that Coach Jones was giving, and the talk that Dartus did, and this is good stuff. This is good life stuff that they're talking to these kids about. So absolutely, I think we have something to partner with these organizations.
In terms of branding, the apparel is often one of the big things along with that. In terms of branding the league, apparel is one of the big things that often goes along with that. Is there any plan to try and partner with somebody, get a contract going to get a bigger apparel provider, and I guess get the brand out there a little more to sell t-shirts and stuff like that?
Yes, there's absolutely, we're not in negotiations with anyone, so I don't want to lead you wrong, but that is something that all of us would like to do. Something that I've heard, and Dartus, you can chime in on this if you'd like, we have people that play from all over North America. We have people that want to buy our gear all over the place. Man, could you give me some of that A swag? I've heard that swag is the hip young term for our... And the reason why, this is like my TV at home, whack, and it comes back on. But the reality is that we've got cool stuff. I mean, Dartus has done a great job of marketing his red jerseys. I mean, young man came in the office today, 12 years old, wearing a jersey autographed by everybody. And I don't like the kid, but that's a whole other story. No, it was great, and he's really a brilliant mind. He loves stats, and we were going through stuff. But yeah, I mean, people want to buy that stuff. They like what our guys are wearing, and it's a way to monetize it. You got any questions?
I think if you look at year one to year three, well, we've only been in 3 years, but the league is now going on its fifth year, we're going on our fourth. We changed, at one point, the whole league had the same provider, and then we went independent. And I think this year we'll go back, if the dollars are correct, and we'll do it again. We'll go under one provider if possible, but then give us a bigger discount than we probably will.
Yes.
When it comes to California, just for some insight, what's the difference between the E-League in the States and the NBL?
The money, I mean, we have the same payroll. The NBA, we have the same payroll with an asterisk. The NBA signs a rookie and they pay him several million dollars. That guy doesn't not going to get any minutes. They move him to play in the D League, so that obviously changes the payroll. The NBA makes all the payments, but those non guys that aren't affiliated with the NBA has the same salary cap that we do. I would argue player to player we're not far off, except for those NBA guys that are already been drafted that they're trying to develop. The difference is Bill Jones runs Bill Jones's system. Bill Jones plays to win every single game. The D-League doesn't play to win. One team does, the Fort Wayne Mad Ants, because they're affiliated with 13 or 14 other teams. Everybody else is a one-team affiliate, like the Raptors and the Raptors 905. They'd love to win a championship, but that's not the most important thing. Developing that player, developing their system, and making certain that is what it is. So the coaches don't have the flexibility to sell. If a guy's not playing well, but the NBA wants you to develop them, you've got to play him 30 minutes. If a guy's a dog, Bill's not getting anything out of him. He's like, you go sit at the end and somebody come in and take your spot. So it's a little different. That's why I think at times we actually can compete with a lot of their teams, because we play from day one to win every game we can. So it's a little different mindset in what we're doing. Are we developing our guys? Sure, that's why guys get better jobs. But it's not just to develop a system or develop one player. We're actually trying to create this really competitive league, and that's what we have.
This is a matter of interest that was on the internet recently, and right across the site was ranked basketball teams in North America. And Windsor ranked 44th, and they were ahead of about half the D-League teams, because the first top 30 teams were NBA, and went from there.
Yeah.
Yes!
Did Bill create that? What?
The sign being shown.
You know what, I would argue, my assistant coach was a 7-foot guy. And he played in the NBA for 13 years. He coached in the NBA or the D League or Division I basketball for over 25 years. When he first came to this league, he's like, this is, you know, I'm a D League coach and I've been there. Very impressed with the talent. Very impressed with the coaching. Very impressed with the level of play. When you come and experience this and you know basketball and you watch it, you're really impressed by it.
Expanding into the U.S.?
That's a great question.
And that's because the market is closer. You know, instead of expanding out west, like we still have the four Canadians would have to be on your team.
Mm-hmm.
And if you had a team in Detroit, I know there's Dartus probably was expecting to go out in the Detroit market. But with passports, it's difficult to get back and forth. But even on the East Coast, expanding with some of the U.S.
Would we consider it? I think we absolutely would consider it. I think, believe it or not, it may be out west. It might be Bismarck and Sioux Falls that are within 5 hours, within 6 hours of Calgary. And they've been good D-League cities, and if they become available and they help round out a division out there, then why not? I mean, like I said, the Raptors don't have a problem putting an NBA team in Canada. If we had a complimentary franchise or two, I don't think that would be a bad look at all for us to play across the border. it would be much easier for us because all of our guys have passports to get here in the first place. So listen, it's never a problem to get a Canadian a passport because everybody has one. But about 80% of Americans don't even have passports. We can expound on why that is later, but you know, ultimately, it would make it pretty easy to do, and I think we're not far away from it. If that option ever came up, we'd have to look at that. Go ahead.
At one point, when we were looking at the casino to do a kind of a benchmark game or a highlighted game, I went to Cobo Hall. I was actually going to do a game in the States and feature and play at the Echo Hall. It didn't work out. We ended up at the casino. But we looked at how can we offer what we have and let them see on the other side as well. So I definitely looked at that.
I wouldn't probably consider NBA cities and cities that have, you know, franchises. It would be more standalone markets that could really support a team.
If I could trouble you with a question there, Coach Banks.
Yes.
Over the last little while, you had some great perspective in terms of just going around the league and different cities and whatnot. And while there have been a lot of negative over the last little while, you've seen a lot of positive things and a lot of positive things being said. What if you can kind of comment on some of the things that you've been seeing?
Well, it's amazing how Game 7 only exists, for the most part, in Halifax and in Windsor. Most of the other franchises have moved on from it because they weren't as directly impacted. So that's a positive thing that really isn't as big a deal as it's been made out to be for the whole league at this point. People are excited about the years to come. The money that's coming into the franchises of the Niagara team, and you know, again, three very smart young men that are entrepreneurs that made their money being smart, were at Game 7, went out afterwards with Dardis and had a little conversation about why should we leave our money in this league and do it, had their $50,000 deposit in and been approved, and was within their 45-day window to get the rest of their $250,000 in. Decide they're gonna put the money in, double down, buy a floor, sign their lease, and go full throttle, regardless of what happened here that night. That's a belief. That's a belief in Dardis's charm. What else did you tell me? It really is a belief in this league. It's a belief in his potential. Listen, I've gotten calls from.
Not on TV.
Yeah, I've gotten a call from Sudbury. I'm getting calls from all over Ontario. People saying I have a lot of interest to put a franchise. Would you be interested? And man, absolutely. I get paid commission. This is great. Just kidding, kind of. We'll take one or two more questions and then we'll wrap it up.
Sorry.
No, this is great.
Just one other thing. I don't know if this helps, but I've tried to figure out why do I like this league so much growing up. Hockey, never thought it was basketball. Yeah, mostly because of Dardis. Shake my hand there. You know, I think one of the things that makes it fun and unique for families is it's accessible. You know, I love Boston Bruins, but the only game I went to see this year was an exhibition game. It's like, you get tickets for $13, right? Like, you take a family of four or five to Joe Louis for a regular season game, it's a fortune, right? So, I don't know, I think that's some way you guys could market it. It's just, you can still get that professional experience, but without the hideous costs of the big leagues.
For the cost of a Raptors, average Raptors ticket, you can take any of our venues, a family of four to a game. Free parking at virtually all of our venues. And when you say accessibility, where I thought you were going and where I would love to go is our autograph zone. Every one of our teams has to sign autographs within 15 minutes at the end of a game. You know, I'm scared of DeAndre Thomas. Let me tell you the truth. He's a big man. He shakes my hands. I've got big hands. They disappear. I'm like, where'd my hand go? I don't want to shake his hand. He looks mean. He looks angry. He gets angry on the court. But I see your kids running up to him like he's the biggest teddy bear going. And he said, yeah, I wish he knew that when he played against us. But it's because they've experienced him. When I played in the NBA, and I used the term played very loosely because I did more sitting than playing, but when I was in the NBA, most of the NBA franchises lost money. And there was a team that's called the Sacramento Kings that used to be in Kansas City.
Yep.
And there was a major indoor soccer league called the Kansas City Comets. And the Kansas City Comets drew 12,000 people a game, and the Kansas City Kings drew 3,000 people a game. It's indoor soccer. We don't even play soccer in America. What the heck are these people coming out to watch? They're coming out to watch Enzo Zepeda. What's an Enzo Zepeda? I don't know, but he's at bar mitzvahs, he's at first communions, he's at mall openings, he's every place you find your Windsor Express today. He's out there in the world doing the work, and people are rewarding him because they've experienced Enzo Zepeda. And then for a couple of years, major indoor soccer outdrew the NBA in Kansas City. And it probably cost the Kansas City Kings their franchise. But ultimately, because the Kansas City Kings players were millionaires that went to their homes in the hills, they got in their Mercedes, and people didn't experience them. They experienced the Express. I talked to your fans the last couple days with Dardis. They love these guys. As much as I may not, they do. And they especially love that coach. And I've seen the passion for him. One more question.
What about free kids' days and free basketball for the kids so they can play basketball at home?
Okay. Now, when you say kids' days, you meant kids, right?
Yes, of course.
Okay. I love him when he does the games. I'll be listening to the games. I'm going, what did he just say? He's the greatest. I'm like, Adarnas, you're a hot person. These two people, if I'm not mistaken, brought their grandchildren to a free kids game. Dardis told their 10-year-old grandson at the time, I hope one day you can, maybe one day, you can play for my team. And the kid's smile went from ear to ear. And they have been sold on the Windsor Express ever since. So every tool that we have to grow sales, I'm certain Dardis considers and thinks about. Free basketballs? You know, what would be great is as a league, if we could source that for them. We met with somebody today from BMR, is that the right term? They're a buying group of building materials, of lumber and stuff like that. The reason you're in a buying group is because you can't compete head to head with Home Depot and Lowe's and those big players. So you collectively buy together so that you can then be competitive. So to be able to do free basketballs, the league needs to take our buying power, and we need to go find some place that says, hey, they may not be great basketballs, but here's 2,000 basketballs we're going to sell you for $2,000, and I can divvy them up amongst the teams, and they can autograph them and send them out, and we can see them all over the playgrounds, logo them up or do whatever. Would you, I can let you talk about the free kids.
You know what we did over the last 3 years, we made sure that those that were underprivileged had access. We had partners that bought blocks of tickets, and we rewarded kids from the community with them. We partnered with some of the other nonprofits and made sure that they received some of the benefits that the other community members bestowed on us. So we basically paid it forward, and from our own standpoint, I made sure that I personally visited and rewarded where I could tickets to make sure that the kids are there. And we'll continue to do that, guys. That doesn't change. That's the good heart of Windsor. And once you walk in Windsor, you see that the one thing we believe in is family, friends, and giving to each other. So it's unlike any place you've ever been. Windsor's a place where you know your neighbor, you're within 1 degree of separation. And, you know, I continue to say that if we share with that 1 degree of separation to come out and enjoy what we have, which is our Windsor Express, it'll continue to grow. Put the W before the D, and you know what that means. Put Windsor before anyone else or Detroit. So we'll continue to do that and give, give, give. It comes back sevenfold.
Thank you.
Good, guys. I guess we're going to wrap it up there. That was awesome. You guys all stuck around. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you, Dave, Mr. Magley, for a really good event. Looking forward to seeing you all when the season starts again in December. We'll definitely see you before then. So again, thanks for coming.